Test. Oh, yes. Sings.
Hello.
There we go.
Yes. We're good. You have to sing a song. Hello. Yes. All right. Good morning. How's everybody this morning? All right. It is a beautiful day outside, and it's going to be, I really want those fall temperatures to stay.
Yes.
But that's just me. I really wanted to wear like a sweater, sweatshirt today, but then I looked and it said it was going to be 80-something. I was like, better not. I don't want to freeze everyone out at church. Aren't you? I'm sure you're pleased of that. All right. Well, we are down some folks today due to illness, so pray for us. We're going to do our best and maybe not sing quite as much as we normally do. So, but we're going to start out with I Am Not Alone. If everybody wants to stand this morning, how many of you know that in your worst days and trials that you are not alone? Amen? That's right. So, sing with us and praise as we sing, I Am Not Alone.
When I walk through deep waters, I know that you will be with me. When I'm standing in the fire, not be overcome.
I love this part.
Through the valley of the shadow, I will not fear, 'cause I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before. Breaking through the dark of night, will not overtake me. I am pressing into you, Lord. You fight. You're my refuge in the storm. Through these trials, you've always been faithful. You bring
design.
give him a praise today that you're not alone. Amen. You may be seated. All right, we just got a few announcements that we're going to talk about. We want you to remember also the prayer requests that you have in your bulletin and those that you hear and see online, and of course those that you have in your own hearts, because God knows what's on our hearts and minds. Amen. So we're going to talk about Mondays is the Truth Project. They're having a really good time with that. And it's not something that you have had to be there from the beginning. So if you want to check it out, you can certainly still do that. Just Mondays at 6 o'clock here. They're doing the Truth Project. Then this Thursday, October 15th, at 6 o'clock is our Real Women's Meeting. We're doing a Thanksgiving tree craft along with a Bible study. So make sure you come out for that. We're putting a lot of time into it. Hopefully it's good. I don't know. We'll see. But we're going to do that. So that'll be good to get us ready for Thanksgiving. And then next Sunday, October 18th, it's one service just at 10:30. So put that on your calendars. Mr. Dylan Brock is going to be here. He is a professional guitarist and singer. And Bob Courtney, that was here a few weeks ago, he is a good friend of his, and so he's going to come and sing and worship with us, and so that'll be a good time. Then Wednesday the 28th, don't forget about our fall party. We're going to be giving prizes out for Best Bible Character Costume and the Carved and Painted Pumpkins. How many of you were here for our Way Got Talent on Wednesday? A few of you? It was a really good time. We gave out a $100 prize, a $50 prize, and a $25 prize. So it's worth your time to participate in these. The way pays out well on prizes, I would say. I never got that much when I was going to church. And then, of course, we're going to do the trunk or treat on the 31st at the square. And so we're going to have a little tent up. We're going to do the armor of God as our theme. So if you've been coming on Wednesday nights, Buddy just finished out that not too long ago. And so if you want to donate some candy, there's a bucket or a tub out in the Welcome Center you can do that on. Mike, if you'll come do the tithes and offerings, and we're going to have Rayla pray over the prayer request and our tithes and offering.
Lord Jesus, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to come today and worship and just be with all the ones on the prayer request list. We know that you know that need. We know that you know what is going on in each of their lives. We even know the unspoken needs that are out there. And help our community, help our government, help our nation as a whole, and just help us to come back to you as a whole. And Jesus, be with the offering, and be with everybody that gives, and be with everybody that can't give. And we just bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. After you give your tithes and offerings, please stand, and we're going to stand in your love.
I thought it was the blessing.
Oh, what is it?
The blessing?
No,
we're doing that. Oh, my bad.
We thank you for the many blessings that you that we can show your love through us. And Lord, we just thank you for this chance to be here today. Be with the preacher as he brings the word today, Lord Jesus, that you will anoint the word and that you will bless it to our hearts and allow us to show other people love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, welcome back. Dave is preaching for us today, and I heard it the first service. It's a great sermon, so you're in for a blessing.
One, am I on? Good, okay. I want to thank Buddy and Christy for the invitation to stand in the pulpit. It's an honor. Because you really don't want people standing in your pulpit. I'm not saying I'm the man, but you don't want people standing in the pulpit that don't love God and don't love His Word. And I do my best to do both very much. Okay. We're going to be talking about a subject called forgiveness. When I started working on this at the beginning of the week, I was thinking mainly about forgiving each other. You know, that we wouldn't hold odd against each other. But God took me to a longer message, and if I preached that, we'd be here till 3 o'clock, and the ball games would be over, and nobody would be happy, especially me. Okay. But today we're going to talk about what forgiveness really is. Have you guys ever thought about the forgiveness that is afforded to us? Just think about it a little bit. We're going to open prayer here. I'm trying to get your brains working. Lord, what a privilege to be able to stand and be your servant. Hold me, Father, to the place where I can show you, Father God, because you are the reason I'm standing up here, Lord. Lord, that people would see your forgiveness, see your love, see your righteousness, Lord, and that we'd walk in it. Lord, I just ask for your just control of my voice, that everything is heard the way you want your Holy Spirit to speak to each heart. In your precious name, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Savior, amen. I really feel that you'll never know what true forgiveness is until you see how ugly sin is. Sin is ugly. And I think we as a church sometimes kind of paint it over. Oh, it's not that bad, you know. We just keep, if we can keep the little sins, we'll be okay. But sin separates us from the relationship that we have with our Heavenly Father, because He cannot fellowship in sin with us. So we need to see that forgiveness is a gift, but it's more than a gift. It's a restoring of our relationship to Him. He paid the debt completely. So we're going to start out, me getting on the right note page. Now, from my study of the scripture, I don't know exactly when Satan was cast to earth. And that was at the fall of mankind. When Adam and Eve decided that, hey, we'll try this new way. And it brought sin into this. And since that day, Satan has been doing his best to have control. The reason I said I don't know when Satan was cast to earth, I don't know if it was before creation or after creation. Part of me thinks it was during after creation, because he saw what God had done. He had created the earth. But not only that, he made this human being in his image, which was the joy and pride of God, that we would be created for him to glorify him. And Satan said, well, that's pretty neat. I'd kind of like to have some of that. So that's where we see the serpent walk in to the garden. I don't know how many years that Adam and Eve were in the garden. They might have been there thousands and thousands of years and having a great time, you know. But the serpent walked into the garden. and offered a different way. He wanted God's creatures to worship him. And since that day, the fall of man, it broke that relationship with our Creator. Well, how many knew that God had a plan? He knew it was going to happen anyway. Before the foundations of the earth, the lamb was slain. If you look at Ephesians chapter 1, let's just turn there. I had it marked in the first service. There it is. We'll start with verse 3. How we praise God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms, because we belong to Christ. Long before he even made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy without fault in his eyes. The unchanging plan has always been to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. And this gave him great pleasure. And it goes on to say in verses 6 through 7 that we were purchased by the Son of God. He had that in his mind and already knew that it was going to take place. He knew that Satan was fall. Adam and Eve. They had a choice, and they made a wrong decision there. Until we see how much sin had taken took humankind out of God's hands into the hands of the enemy. How it separated that relationship. You know, Adam and Eve walked with God daily. They communed with God daily, but sin came in and separated that relationship, and we don't have that relationship. We didn't have that relationship. We do have the relationship now through Jesus Christ. But it was through that the world went into sin. Now, does anybody see a problem with sin in the world? I guess. You guys can talk. You guys can say things. I mean, think of this as a classroom at high school. Is it quiet in classrooms at high school? No. It wasn't when I was in high school anyway. People like me always get in trouble. Okay. So we see that forgiveness is something that's needed to bring that, restore that relationship back with our Creator. Now, Satan has been trying ever since then to keep us in his control. And since Satan is a created being, he's not all-knowing. So he hung around with these prophets and teachers through the Old Testament. He got this, hey, there's going to be this king coming. This king coming, and he's going to separate the people and deliver them, and he's going to free them. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll make sure that he does not live. So what happens when Jesus showed up on earth? The Pharisees and the Sadducees started growing in envy, and they came to this point where we need to take him out. And then Satan messed with Judas's mind a little bit and said, hey, you want to make some money? Betray this guy. And Satan, upon Good Friday, thought he had conquered the enemy again. He thought he had conquered it at the fall of man, but he thought he conquered it again because he had killed the king that was going to free the people. Well, since he wasn't all-knowing, he didn't know that 3 days later this guy was going to show back up. Okay? He didn't know Jesus was going to rise. And from that day, our forgiveness was purchased. The blood restored that relationship with mankind. But it's not a complete restoration because mankind's involved where he has to humble himself, pray, repent, to come into that fullness of walking with Jesus again, walking with God again. We see, I'm turning my page here because I don't want to miss anything. I wrote it down, it must have been good, right? No. We see that in Romans 3:23 that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So there's not one of us here in this room that is not short of the glory of God. Well, let me take that back. There's not one that was in this world that was short of the glory of God. By coming to Jesus Christ, we became back to the glory of God. Let's turn to Zechariah 3. This is where the main message was spoke of in the Old Testament. I'm sure you did. But this, to me, explains what conversion really happens at conversion. Zechariah 3. Then the angel, it's on the screen so you guys can follow it there if you don't have it in your word. It's in the NIV. No, it isn't. It's in the NLT, okay? But the old NLT, this is way back there. It reads different even in the new NLT. But okay. Then the angel showed me Jeshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord. Satan was there. Did you know that Satan's in the throne room with God? And he's making accusations day in and day out. Why you are not worthy? Why you cannot be in fellowship with him? Why you cannot be his children? The Lord said to Satan, I, the Lord, reject your accusations. Satan, yes, the Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebukes you. This man is like a burning stick that has been snatched from the fire. That's all we are, folks. We're burning sticks that have been snatched from the fire by the redemption of Jesus Christ. Because without him, that would be our judgment. Joshua's clothing was filthy, and he stood there before the angel. So the angel said to the other standing there, take off his filthy clothes. And turning to Joshua, he said, see, I have taken away your sins, and now I am giving you new clothes. We're snatched from the fire, and our filthy rags are removed, and we come into right standing through the new clothing. We are now his because of that new clothing. Our sins have been taken away. And I want to just jump down to verse 9 and 10. Now look at the jewel I have set before Jeshua, a single stone of 7 facets. I will engrave the inscription on the sins of this land in a single day. Anybody have an idea what that single day was? You guys can talk. Good Friday. Do you know that on Good Friday, every sin that has ever been committed, every sin that will be committed, and every sin that is being committed right now was totally forgiven? Now, that's an awesome thing if you get thinking about it, because forgiveness is saying that that debt has been paid. There's no longer any debt for that sin. Now, whether we receive that or not, or believe that, that's in our hands. God can do. The holy, sinless blood of Jesus Christ was shed, and all sin was gone for 100 years. It means my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren, their sins have already been forgiven because of the price that was paid on Good Friday. Now, the first Easter took care of the curse of sin, death, when he rose from the grave. But sin was paid for in full. I don't know how I could really explain that anymore. There's not a sin that you think of or do or going to do that hasn't been blessed. See, before, in the Old Testament, when they brought the little lamb before the altar and removed its blood, the sins were just forgiven. I mean, just covered. They're still there. The sins had not been paid for. They were just covered so that God could look upon his people at that time, because that was what was separating his people from him, was their sin. So through the blood of lambs and goats, it was covered. But it wasn't forgiven yet. It was just covered. And I don't have time to go into the full theology of forgiveness, where that was taken care of through the blood of Jesus Christ and how it was taken care of. But that, search the scriptures and see what I say. Bad place for the mic. See that what I'm telling you is from the scriptures. Because believe me, if you're just believing it because I'm standing up here, then you're just coming to church. You're not really seeking God. Because you have to know what the word says. Because I am what? Human. And I make mistakes. And I sin. Just like all my brothers and sisters that are here. In fact, I kind of agree with Paul. I'm the chief of sinners. And on that day, verse 10 says, and on that day, says the Lord Almighty, each one of you will invite your neighbor into your house and share your peace and prosperity. And time for a drink. Inviting my neighbors in to partake of this peace and prosperity that God has given me through the forgiveness of sins. That's something we should be doing. They need to know what the blood of Christ did, what happened on that Good Friday. And it's called Good Friday. I wrote my notes down the first time. I don't know how I wrote Black Friday. Okay. But I did. And then maybe it's because it was kind of a dark and dreary day. And if you ever want to watch a great little clip on the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Tony, I can't think of his last name, wrote on, forget it. It popped in my mind and went out the other side. Okay. I'll remember it somewhere along. Okay, let's go to the second main scripture, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 11 through 25. It says in verse 19, we're going to read at 11, but in verse 19 it says, it's by a new and living way that we can enter into the Holy of Holies, or the God's throne room, in verse 19 of this chapter. But I want to see what they had to go through each and every day, repeatedly, for forgiveness of sins. And I don't know why I'm not there. Okay. Verse 11 says, under the old covenant, the priest stands before the altar day after day. Can you imagine what he gets up in the morning, alarm clock goes off? Well, I don't know if they have the alarm clocks in. Sundial will go off, whatever. And he says, you know, I'm going to have to into the Holy of Holies, but I have to go and kill a lamb today, and a goat, some pigeons, all the things it took to cover the blood, cover the sins of the people. Day after day, repeatedly. I mean, if I was a priest back then, I would think about changing tribes. I wouldn't be a leader. But it says, day after day, offering sacrifices that can never, especially if you knew that it could never take away sin. It could only cover sin. It could never take away sin. But our high priest offered himself to God as one sacrifice for sin, good for all time. Jesus being crucified on the cross, one time. That did it. And that did not only cover the sins, it paid the debt so that it is not charged to us anymore. And to me, that's awesome. You guys can say hallelujah or amen or something. I mean, and mean it, of course. Oh, my back. Okay. Where was I at here? Okay. In verse 13. No. 12. And sits at the right down at the right place of highest honor at the right hand of God. There he waits for his enemies until his enemies are humbled as a footstool under his feet. For by one offering he perfected forever all those whom he is making holy. That's us, folks. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so. This is the new covenant I will make with my people, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their heart so that they will understand them, and I will write them on their mind so they will obey them. Before, the law was written on what? Tablet, right? You had your five here, you had your five here, and then you had a bunch of other 6,000 other laws that the Pharisees and Sadducees came up with. They were on stone. Where are they at now? Where's the law at now? In us. It's written on our hearts and our minds. That's, to me, is blows me away, but that I walk around with the law of God in me at all times. It's not just memorized. It's there. There's a difference between memorizing something. I still remember my ABCs from kindergarten. I memorized my ABCs. What good does it do me anymore? You know, what it does, I guess. I'm right, words and things. But just memorizing something doesn't really put it into effect. It's when it's in your heart and your mind that it's part of you and it goes with you. Everything you do. And the law of God is written on us so that everything we do, we have to make a decision at the time it comes in our mind. It says in 2 Corinthians 10 that we are to take every head, you have to take them captive at that time. It might be a good thought, you think, at that time. Because even good thoughts can turn out bad. And I think I've given that illustration before. You know, if I want to help an elderly lady across the street, that's a good thing, right? That's a good thought. But I better make sure there's no truck coming, okay? Just because it's a good thought, I shouldn't just do it. I have to see what's around. What's going on? Because believe me, if I was trying to help somebody across the street and a truck was coming, I'd probably skedaddle, and that would be wrong too. So I know I couldn't stop a truck, okay? But so we have to see that the law is written on our mind for the purpose of what? Instructing us on what to do, what direction to go, how to walk, how to sit. And when I say sit, I'm not talking about just sitting down. I'm talking about where we rest at. How do we rest? Are we resting in him or are we resting in the world? And a lot of times I rest in the world. It's sad when toward the end of the week you're saying, man, I can't wait to Saturday. Why? I'm not looking for Sunday at church. Sorry. I'm just being honest. I'm saying, oh, I don't have to go back to work. I'm thinking about me, my pleasure, my desire. Instead of taking that thought and saying, okay, God, that's a good thought to have. Now, what do you have me to do this weekend? What do you have me, who do you have me going and talking to? Who do you have me walking with? Which neighbor should I be praying for? Our life is more than just work, going home, and doing things. It's, we are enlisted in an army, the army of God, and we got a work to do. We got to fight to fight. It goes on in verse 19. It says, so dear brothers, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. This is the new living, this is the new life-giving way that Christ has opened up through the sacred curtain. Why, which means his death for us. You know what's so hard about reading some of this sometimes, being in the ministry for? I've memorized all these scriptures in about five different versions. So you get here and you start to read them and you jump because you remember a different version. But a new and living way, which was through his death, his body. All those years in the Old Testament, that curtain was the body of Christ. It's saying, there's forgiveness here. And upon his death, that curtain was opened so that we can enter into the throne room of God. That you guys don't need to come to a guy like me and say, can you pray for me so I be forgiven? You can drop on your own knees and cry out to your maker, creator. Forgiveness is a wonderful thing, but you don't really know the power of it until you see how bad sin is that separates you from that. We church people are so good at characterizing sins, you know. Well, a little lie, hey, that's just a little one. A sexual sin, you know, or if you murder somebody, that's bad. No. Every sin is bad because it separates you from that relationship with your Heavenly Father. You are His child, and He made it a way that you can sit on His lap and be part, be in His presence. As we see that since He did this, that we have a great high priest who rules over God's people, let us go into the presence of God with a true heart, with true hearts, fully trusting Him, for our evil consciences have been sprinkled by what? Christ's blood. That's what makes them clean. And our bodies have been washed with pure water, the living water. Without wavering, let's hold tight to the hope we say we have for God and be trusted to keep His promises. To outburst love and good deeds. I like the King James Version of that verse better. It says, spur one another unto good works. Now, what is a spur? It's uncomfortable to a horse, guys. We should come to a point where we make our brothers and sisters uncomfortable being idle in church. Because we were not saved to be idle. Because basically, to be idle in church is making yourself idle. The idol. You're the one that you're thinking about. Okay? He says, spur one another into good works. That means we should be encouraging one another to be living a witness life, okay? To helping others, serving people. We have that responsibility. And sometimes we don't take it. And then, of course, the next verse, a lot of people don't really like in the Bible. And let us not neglect meeting together, as some people do, but encourage and warn each other, especially now in the day of His coming back soon is drawing near. Okay? So we have a responsibility. Remember that the law of God was written in our hearts and our minds now. Like I said, when I started working on this message, I was going to mainly talk about how we have a responsibility to forgive those who sinned against us or have. Because in the Lord's Prayer, the Lord taught that we are to forgive, ask for forgiveness as we forgive those who trespass against us. And a lot of times it's very hard to forgive people who hurt us knowingly and unknowingly. Sometimes, man, I've been in situations where I knew that person did that on purpose and find out that they had no idea that it even happened. And just because we see an action or a reaction that it was done unto us, we intern it. And that's where we should take those things that are, we intern to us and turn to Him because He has paid the price. He has forgiven. On how to restore a relationship with our brothers and sisters, and even our non-Christian brothers and sisters. There's some restoring that needs to happen with neighbors, with relatives, with spouses, there's some restoring that has to happen there, but it can only be done through the Christ's blood, which paid for the debt. Forgiveness, I don't think we give it enough thought. We say, oh, I'm a child of God. But I can only speak for me, okay? When I look at my past, I look at my life, and I say, God, how can you forgive such a man? So, I agree with that, too. How can you forgive to blaspheme your name? A man who used to make jokes, well, I'll just go and drink beer with my buddies in hell, if that's what's going to happen to me. A man who hurt so many people. But you know what? I'm created in the image of God. It blows me away. The Almighty God, I'm in His image. And if I'm not showing Him to the world, folks, I don't have a good relationship with Him. That means I have an eternal spirit in me. That means I know right from wrong. It means I have love in me. And so many times we get caught up in ourselves. And who do you think is one of the greatest instigators of that? Not my wife. Not Christy or not anybody else. It's Satan himself. Because if he can get his eyes off of my Savior, he has accomplished what he set out to do. We're going to play a song now. I'm not going to sing, so you guys can remain calm. I'm going to step to the side, and there's going to be a song on the screen. And afterwards, we'll close and
thing on your mind today, it always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they caused is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. Pride, it moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Oh, forgiveness.
to sing and stand with us as we praise today. If you have anything on your heart today that you'd like to be prayed for, any unforgiveness that you're maybe harboring or that you want to the Lord to help you with, feel free. Our altars are open, and Dave's here to pray with you if you want to be prayed with. Or, but just praise Him as we sing the blessing.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace.
Sing it with us today.
The Lord bless you. His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace.
Message on unforgiveness, Lord, that we can, if we have unforgiveness others, Lord, but the biggest gift that you ever gave us, Lord, was sending your Son to die on the cross, Lord, for our sins, that no matter what we do, we are forgiven, Lord. If we have asked you into our hearts, Lord, that as Dave said today, no matter what we've done, what we're going to do in the future, Lord, you have forgiven it by your Son's blood, Lord. We just thank you for this service today. We thank you for all the hearts and minds that are here, Lord. We just ask that you give us a great week, Lord, and bring us back next week. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, have a great week, and come back next Wednesday. This Wednesday. I bet. It's the next, right?